The Master of the Harvest Part 2. Meantime, when she opened her Bible that night, she wrote on the flyleaf the text, "Wherefore should a man complain, a man for the punishment of his sins?" And after the text the date of the day, and after the date the words, "Thou dost turn thy face from us, and we are troubled, but, Lord, how long, how long?" And by came on the long-delayed times of refreshing, but so slowly and imperfectly that the change in the corn could scarcely be detected for a while. Nevertheless, it told at last, and stems struggled up among the blades, and burst forth into flowers, which gradually ripened into ears of grain. But a struggle it had been, and continued to be, for the measure of moisture was scant, and the due amount of warmth in the air was wanting. Nevertheless, by struggling and effort the young wheat advanced, little by little, in growth, preparing itself, minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day, as best it could. For the great day of the harvest. As best it could. Would the Master of the Harvest ask more? Alas, he had still something to find fault with, for when he looked at the ears and saw that they were small and poor, he grumbled, and said the yield would be less than it ought to be, and the harvest would be bad. And as more weeks went on, and the same weather continued, and the progress was very, very slow, he spoke out of his vexation to his wife at home, to his friends at the market, and to the husbandmen who passed by and talked with him about the crops. And the voice of his discontent was breathed over the cornfield, all along the long ridges where the plants were laboring, and waiting, and watching. And they shuddered and murmured, "How cruel to complain! Had we been idle, had we been negligent, had we been indifferent, we might have passed away without bearing fruit at all. How cruel to complain!" But of all this the Master of the Harvest heard nothing, so he did not cease to complain. Meantime, another week or two went on, and people as they glanced over the land wished that a few good rainy days would come and do their work decidedly, so that the corn ears might fill. And behold, while the wish was yet on their lips, the sky became charged with clouds, darkness spread over the country, a wild wind rose, and the growling of thunder announced a storm. And such a storm. People hid from it in cellars and closets and dark corners, as if now, for the first time, they believed in a God, and were trembling at the new-found fact, as if they could never discover him in his sunshine and blessings, but only thus in his tempests and wrath. And all along the long ridges of wheat plants drove the rain-laden blast, and they bent down before it and rose up again, like the waves of a laboring sea. Ears over ears they bowed down, ears above ears they rose up. They bowed down as if they knew that to resist was destruction, they rose up as if they had a hope beyond the storm. Only here and there, where the whirlwinds were the strongest, they fell down and could not lift themselves again. So the damage done was but little, and the general good was great. But when the Master of the Harvest saw here and there patches of overweighted corn yet dripping from the thunder showers, he grew angry for them, and forgot to think of the long ridges that stretched over his fields, where the corn ears were swelling and rejoicing. And he came in gloomy to his home, when his wife was hoping that now, at last, all would be well, and when she looked at him the tumult of her soul grew beyond control, and she knelt down before him as he sat moody in his chair, and threw her arms round him, and cried out, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not utterly consumed. Oh, husband, pray for the corn and for me, that it may go well with us at the last. Carry me upstairs." And his anger was checked by fear, and he carried her upstairs and laid her on the bed, and said it must be the storm which had shaken her nerves. But whether he prayed for either the corn or her that night she never knew. And presently came a new distress, for when the days of rain had accomplished their gracious work, and every one was satisfied, behold, they did not cease. And as hitherto the cry had gone up for water on the furrows, so now men's hearts failed them for fear lest it should continue to overflowing, and lest mildew should set in upon the full, rich ears, and the glorious crops should be lost. And the Master of the Harvest walked out by his cornfields, his face darker than ever. And he railed against the rain because it would not cease, against the sun because it would not shine, against the wheat because it might perish before the harvest. But why does he always and only complain, moaned the corn plants, as the new terror was breathed over the field. Have we not done our best from the first? And has not mercy been with us, sooner or later, all along? When moisture was scant, and we throve but little, why did he not rejoice over that little, and wait, as we did, for more? Now that abundance has come, and we swell triumphant in strength and in hope, why does he not share our joy in the present, and wait in trust, as we do, for the future ripening change? Why does he always complain? has he himself some hard master, who would fain reap where he has not sown, and gather where he has not strewed, and who has no pity for his servants who strive, but of all this the master of the harvest heard nothing. And when the days of rain had rolled into weeks and the weeks into months, and the autumn set in, and the corn still stood up green in the ridges, as if it never meant to ripen at all, the boldest and most hopeful became uneasy, and the master of the harvest despaired, but his wife had risen no more from her bed, where she lay in sickness and suffering, yet in patient trust, watching the sky through the window that faced her pillow, looking for the relief that came at last. For even at the 11th hour, when hope seemed almost over, and men had half learned to submit to their expected trial, the dark days began to be varied by a few hours of sunshine, and though these passed away, and the gloom and rain returned again, yet they also passed away in their turn, and the sun shone out once more. And the poor sick wife, as she watched, said to those around her that the weather was gradually changing, and that all would come right at last, and sighing a prayer that it might be so with herself also, she had her Bible brought to the bed, and wrote in the flyleaf the text, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold, and after the text the date of the day, for on that day the sun had been shining steadily for many hours. And after the date the words, unto whom much is given, of him shall much be required, yet if thou, Lord, be extreme to mark iniquity, O Lord, who may stand, and day by day, the hours of sunshine were more in number, and the hours of rain and darkness fewer, and by degrees the green corn ears ripened into yellow, and the yellow turned into gold, and the harvest was ready, and the laborers not wanting. And the bursting corn broke out into songs of rejoicing, and cried, at least we have not waited and watched in vain. Surely goodness and mercy have followed us all the days of our life, and we are crowned with glory and honor. Where is the master of the harvest, that he may claim his own with joy? But the master of the harvest was bending over the bed of his dying wife. And she whispered that her Bible should be brought, and he brought it, and she said, open it at the flyleaf at the end, and write, it is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption, it is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory, it is sown in weakness, it is raised in power, it is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. And she bade him add the date of the day, and after the date of the day, the words, O Lord, in thy mercy say of me, she hath done what she could. And then she laid her hand in his, and so fell asleep in hope. And the harvest of the earth was gathered into barns, and the gathering day of rejoicing was over, and the master of it all sat alone by his fireside, with his wife's Bible on his knee. And he read the texts and the dates and the prayers, from the first day when the corn seeds were held back by drought, and as he read a new heart seemed to burst out within him from the old one, a heart which the Lord of the other harvest was making soft, and the springing whereof he would bless. And henceforth, in his going out and coming in from watching the fruits of the earth, the texts and the dates and the prayers were ever present in his mind, often rising to his lips, and he murmured and complained no more, let the seasons be what they would and his fears however great, for the thought of the late sprung seed in his own dry cold heart, and of the long suffering of him who was Lord and Master of all, was with him night and day. And more as he prayed for help, that the weary struggle might be blessed, and the newborn watching and waiting not be in vain, so more and more there came over his spirit a yearning for that other harvest, where he and she who had gone before might be gathered in together. And thus, in one hope of their calling, the long divided hearts were united at last.